32nd chapter of Genesis.
Let thee go, except thou bless me.
and said unto him, Why is thy name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, Thy name shall be no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince thou hast power with God and with men, and hast prevailed. And Jacob asked him and said, Tell me, I pray, thy name. And he said, Wherefore is it that thou dost ask my name? And he blessed him there. And Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. The Lord has a blessing upon the reading of his holy and his divine word.
Hallelujah.
I was attempting to preach on the subject this morning, if you will, a Smackdown. At midnight. Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, our Father.
Yes.
Now in the beginning we come.
Yes.
Pray, God, that you might bless me. Show more of thee and less of me. Hide me behind the hollow of thy cross.
Yes.
Speak to me, Lord, that you might speak through me. In Jesus' name, for Christ's sake. And all the believers declare, Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Despite what many of you might have been told, or even what many of you might believe, the greatest wrestling match that ever took place was not between Hulk Hogan and Ric Flair. It was not the SmackDown that took place between The Rock versus Stone Cold Steve Austin. But the Bible is full of struggles and bouts between various people. Smackdown. Whether it was Samson versus the Philistines, or David versus Goliath. Whether it's family members like Cain versus Abel, or Esau versus Jacob. Here we have in the 32nd chapter of Genesis, we have the account of one of the greatest smackdowns in all of history. It was a wrestling bout between Jacob that translated him into Israel. Jacob had all the time been cheapened by trickery and deceit. For all of this time, his destiny was enshrouded in obscurity and controversy. He was a vagabond and a servant of others, constantly living in fear and not sure of his footsteps. He was a shadow of his death. But he always found a way to get his way. And now we find him in his present state. In chapter 32, he is on the run. He is running from his past. The text seems to suggest that he had gotten tired of running and he was looking for rest. He was looking for a place that he could confront and be comfortable with who he was. Like most of us, we think that our greatest struggles in life are those external things, but in reality, the greatest struggle that you would ever have in your life will be those internal things. The greatest fight that you'll ever have is the fight that you have with you. We don't understand that there is a place in God where your Abram can become Abraham. Where your Jacob can become story because we fail to realize that Jacob was not the end of his story, but Jacob was who he started off to be. Amen. To this point, Jacob was known to be a trickster. And in fact, he had gradually conned his way to where he was. Amen. But Jacob understood that even stealing and snatching his brother's birthright from his brother Esau was not enough to get him to where he really wanted to be. How many of you know you can't trick your way to where God wants you to be? You can't get there by hook and crook. Amen. He realized that in order to further, he had to fight. So Jacob set up a less than known moment in his life. Amen. Jacob prepares himself for a smackdown with God. Verse 22 says, "And Jacob got up that night and sent his two wives and two concubines and 11 sons across the Jordan River. Then it said that after they were there, he sent over all of his possessions." Somebody need to hear me. Now, three things I want us to observe in this text this morning. I want to talk about the Lord, the limp, and the leap. Let me say that again. I want to talk about the Lord, the limp, and the leap. Because first and foremost, I believe that Jacob's primary struggle was a struggle with the Lord. Amen. Jacob was wrestling with his relationship with God. How many of you ever been there where you had to wrestle with your relationship with God? Well, some of you didn't even believe that you had a relationship with God. Amen. Jacob reached the point that he needed to spend some time alone with God. And there are places in all of our lives where only God can be with us, where only God can really help us and assist us in where we need to be. Amen. There's a place, hear me somebody, where your spouse can't help you. Amen. There's a place where boyfriends and girlfriends and frat brothers and sorority sisters and boom coons and homies cannot assist you. Amen. There's a time when you need to sort out things with God. You don't need to hear the chatter that doesn't matter from somebody else. Amen. Times when we need to shut out and shut down any other interest competing with your destiny in God. Amen. When you need to get away from folk and folk need to get away from you. Amen. Even Moses needed a Mount Sinai. Elijah needed a brook called Cherith. Daniel needed a lion's den. Jesus needed a mountain of transfiguration. We all need personal and private time with God. It's not going to be enough for you just to come to church on Sunday and hear a Sunday sermon or come to Bible study on Tuesday and get a good lesson. But there comes a time in your life that you need to spend some personal time with God. You need to devote some time to God. You can't have a relationship without fellowship. You can't have a union without communion. You can't have a testimony without text. Amen. So Jacob reached the point where he wanted to confront God and be confronted by God. He was preparing for a smackdown with the Lord. Jacob was tired of sleepless night. Anybody like that? Just tired of sleepless nights. Tired of staying up all night, worrying about one thing or another.
door, how to get there. Tired of living a life of deceit and despair. Tired of not measuring up to your full potential. Tired of being a half of what God intended for you to be. So Jacob finds himself in the middle of a wrestling match. Jacob finds himself in the middle of a Smackdown. But can I ask a question? How do you struggle with somebody who you thought was on your side? How do you fight with somebody that's supposed to be in your corner? How do you win against an opponent that knows more about you than you know about yourself? Like Jacob, sometimes we get into fights and in the midst of the fight, we're not sure whether or not we can win the fight. You might be decided to fight, but now you're not sure whether or not you can win the fight. We all got decided. But sometimes life presents us with those fight or die moments. When you want to move beyond where you are, but you need to know whether or not God is still with you. So like Jacob, we have to become more persistent with God. It is one thing to get up all night and walk the halls of your house or sit in the bathroom and run the water so nobody can hear you crying or the tears falling from your eyes. But Jacob wasn't just up all night. He wrestled. And not only did he wrestle, but Jacob was tenacious. Jacob wasn't willing to let up, give up, and Jacob wasn't willing. Jacob wanted to hear from God. You ever get to that point in your life that you need to hear from God? God, I need to hear from you about my financial situation. God, I need to hear from you about my relationship with so-and-so. God, I need to hear from you. And God, I'm not going to go back to sleep until I hear from you. And I got to wrestle with you all night long.
When others were sleeping, Jacob was in the middle of a snack man.
Jacob had a goal because Jacob knew that if only God could stop that, only God could change his destiny.
There's some folk right now who need to be invested in changing your destiny. Because the way the things look, if somebody don't help you, you're on your way to a hot head. Somebody need to hear that. Like Jacob, you ought not let go until God blesses you. Jacob knew that he could not win, but he refused to lose. Give me somebody. And that's what God honored in Jacob's fight. He refused to give up. His unwillingness to stay in the state that he was. And that's what you got to do sometimes. You got to reach a point in your life and say, God, I reached a point that enough is enough. I'm not going to live like this anymore. I'm not going to act like this anymore. But God, you got to move me from where I am to where you want to be. God, I can't stay back. I can't take another thing up in this house. I'm going to lose my mind. Up in here. God, you got to bless me. You got to turn around life. You got to pick me up from where I am to where you want me to be. God, I can't do it no more.
Jacob was unwilling to see where it was. The Bible said that Jacob was wrestling with a man. Some said it was an angel, but Jacob could not be discouraged. Discouragement was not in his dictionary. Jacob refused to throw in the towel. And hear what Jacob told the angel. Jacob said to the angel, I will not let go until you bless me. You have a right to say that. If you have been obedient to God and done what God has told you to do, and you walk by faith and not by sight, you have a right to stay before God and say, God, I'm not going to let go until you bless me.
Come on, Pastor.
Jacob understood that effectual prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Jacob kept on pushing, an acronym which means praying until something happened. The Bible said that when Jacob saw that angel persisted, when the angel saw Jacob persisted, that he prevailed not against Jacob. But they touched the hollow of his back. Now the hollow of one's back is a place of strength. If I'm wrestling with somebody and this is my pivot foot and I'm trying to push myself forward, that I'm gonna get my strength from here, I'm gonna get my strength from out of the hollow of my thigh. I can't, but if you break my thigh, I can't push. So the angel reached down and touched Jacob's hip. The hollow of his thigh. The hollow one thigh is a place of strength. So much so that in Jewish custom, they refuse to eat any backside of the animal because they're afraid they might accidentally eat a part of the fat. Jonah. But when God touched Jacob's thigh, God was telling Jacob, you're not winning because you can win. You're winning because I have allowed you to win. You're winning because you understand that your strength doesn't come from you alone, but your strength comes from the Lord. And that's what Jacob was doing. Jacob was trying to understand his relationship with God. He was trying to understand where his strength really came from. And when Jacob found all the joy, he was no longer fighting to win. But in the midst of the fight, Jacob said, if I can just hold on. I know I can't win, but I got to hold on. I can't let go. In the midst of your trials, in the midst of your struggle, you got to hold on to God's unchanging hand. You got to trust that God can bring you through whatever it is that you're going through. You got to put your elbows on the ground, God, and hold on. When I grabbed hold of minister's knee, I could feel the strength in his body. I knew he was going to shake me around like a rag doll. But I tell you, if he tried to shake me, I wasn't going to let go. I was going to hold on. I ain't let minister knee beat me up in front of all y'all. But Jacob was fighting to hold on. Jacob was surrendering his will to the will of God. Jacob's limp was a reminder of what God had brought him through and what God had delivered him from. Jacob's limp wasn't disabling, but enabled him to see the power of God. Hear me, somebody. Often in our struggles, God is allowing us to push against him so that we can feel the awesomeness of his power and his strength. Sometimes God allows us to be faced with a mountain so that we'll know that we don't have to climb the mountain, but if we just got faith, we can move the mountain. Yes, sir. Sometimes God allows us to be in the midst of a storm so that we'll know that we can make it through storm. Jacob's limp was a part of his transformation to Israel. From a deceiver to Israel, to one who struggles with God and won. And many of you know, God will turn your limp into a leap. I remember when I was a young boy one time. I remember I saw a fight. One of my wrestling, the World Confederation Wrestling Committee, I believe. I used to love to watch. Some of y'all don't even remember this fighter. His name was Dusty Rhodes. And Dusty Rhodes was sort of like my idol wrestler. I used to like to wrestle, like to watch him wrestle.
Yes, sir.
But one day he had to match up against this newcomer by the name of Ric Flair. And Ric Flair used to walk around the ring, and when he used to walk around the ring, he used to shake his blonde head. And Dustin Rhodes was laying on his back. And Ric Flair was just marching around him and throwing his head back and thrusting his head out.
Woo!
And he kept doing it. And I thought that Ric Flair was going to jump in on Dustin Rhodes. But in the midst of the fight, Dustin Rhodes went and touched him back. And when he touched another person, the other person jumped in the ring. But I'm trying to let you know that in the midst of your fight sometimes, you got to know that you got some folk that's also on the side. You got the other folk that's in your corner. And you got to just touch the other person and let them know that it's not that it's not my fight alone, but it's part of your fight. God, not just the Lord, the limb, but it's also a leap. That there's a leap that you've got to talk about. Won't you talk about the leap for a little while?
Jacob had to leap over some obstacles.
Come on, somebody.
Just like us, we have to leap over some things. Because the devil will try to test us.
Yeah.
But put things in our way to stop us from doing something.
Yeah.
But God gave us a leaping advantage over the devil.
Oh, yeah.
Since we have to leap that leaping advantage over the devil, we shouldn't let anything hinder us. There will be some things in our life that we won't be able to leap over.
Yeah, yeah.
But Jacob had an angel.
Come on, somebody.
And just like Jacob had an angel, God is going to give us an angel to help us. God gave Jacob an angel to change his limp into his feet.
Yeah.
Even though God gave Jacob an angel, when Jacob got that angel, everything in his life had changed because of the angel.
Yeah.
But after a while, Jacob had to take a leap of faith.
Come on.
Come by to let you know, even though we're young and we may not be ready.
Uh-huh.
And since we may not be ready, God is waiting right for you to fall if you leap.
Uh-huh.
Because when you fall, he's going to run towards you and pick you up off the ground.
That's all right.
But sometimes in our journey, we may not have to leap over something.
Uh-huh.
Everybody step out of the aisle. Let's stretch our legs. Everybody get up and step out of the aisle. I need everyone to step out of the aisle. When you step out of the aisle, come on, Deacon Harris. Come on, Sister Smith. Come on, boy. Give us space just because you like to leap. Now, somebody may have depression in their life. Somebody may have something in their life. So when you got depression in their life, all you got to do is leap.
Yeah.
Now you can leave for happiness.
Yeah.
I'll look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, always on top of things. We need to be like Jacob. And sometimes we need to give our will to God.
Yeah.
And let God just take control.
Yeah.
Because if God takes control of your life, everything that you ask for in His name, each child comes to pass. Oh my God, like I told you earlier, Jesus, my soon coming King. Jesus, my mind regulator. Jesus, my Prince of Peace. Jesus, my heart of heart. Jesus, my will in the middle of will. Jesus, my burden. Some like to call him Jesus, but I like to call him Father. Wonderful. Able. Almighty God. First and last. Beginning and end. Alpha and Omega. Do we have any Jacobs in the house? Do we have any Jacobs in the house? Just like Jacob. We're going to will ourselves to God. And since we're going to take a leap of faith, we're going to leap into His arms. We're going to leap into our destiny. It's destined for us to be what we are. And what we should be is better. We thank God for making us who we are. But we got more in us. We got more to walk the walk and talk the talk. We can turn around, but just like Jacob, he willed himself to God. How many of you want to will yourself to God? Come on, lift up your hands and say, I will myself to you, Jesus. Because Jesus, if it had not been for my Lord, who was on my side, where would I be? I could have been swallowed up, sleeping in my grave. But God came right along with me. He walked with me. He talked to me. He listened to me. He carried me. Sometimes I like to say thank you. We thank you right now, Jesus.
Let the church say amen. The Lord, the limp and a leap, a smackdown at midnight. Maybe there's somebody right now that you've been having a smackdown at midnight. You've been wrestling with God for a long time now. And you've been struggling with a place that God would have to do. God says, I'm going to take you to a new place right now in the name of you. Why don't y'all stand right now? And I'm going to send it up right now. Won't y'all stand? Won't you stand? The doors of the church open right now. You know that the Lord and the power of your sin. If you didn't get the surrender of your life to Jesus, won't you come right now? Won't you come? If you're looking for a church home, if you're looking for a church to be a part of, that you can roll up your sleeves and get to work in, won't you come right now in the name of Jesus? The doors of the church are open. Won't you join this church by faith, by Christian experience, by baptism? Won't you come right now?